met Van at the Holocaust Education Center when I was a volunteer. He was young and curious. I was old and curious. I think he wanted his feelings confirmed by our mutual experiences. As we got to know each other, he would chide me that he suffered from an obscure genocide, and I was lucky to have the famous one. I told him I was not lucky for that reason, and he understood. He often wished he had died along with his parents. He couldn't understand why he survived. It was a burden to him. He felt he was kind of a walking dead, alone with the enormity of his memories. The truth is, he was alone. When we became friends, I introduced him to matzo ball soup. He never did quite take a liking to it. I always felt it was a success if I got him to smile. Then I wondered if it wasn't cruel to make a man so much in pain smile, a man with so many reasons to be in pain. And what did he introduce you to, Louise says. The old man says, a fruit dish of sticky rice and durian. I don't recommend it. But he also introduced me to art galleries of the alternative kind. Art held a special fascination for him because very few Cambodian artists survived the genocide. He wondered why artists were so important to eradicate. We made an odd pair, the ancient German Jew and the young doctor from Cambodia. It was in one of these galleries that he came upon your sculpture of Louise Michel. Cambodia had been colonized by France, and Van studied French history and became enamored of the Paris Commune and the bravery of those wanting to make a new society out of a diseased one. As a doctor, he was outraged by the greed of the pharmaceutical companies who controlled the flow of life-saving drugs in the developing world. He wanted to act. He wanted to do something dramatic. He struggled with the reactions of his friends and colleagues. They just weren't outraged by the inequities of the world. They were decent people, but their interests were primarily entertaining themselves and enjoying life. He would ask them, what would they have done if they lived in the days of slavery? Of course, they would be outraged, but he didn't believe them. He thought that slavery lasted as long as it did because the wealthy controlled it, and wealth decides what is moral. Louise says, I think I would have liked this Van person. Ah, so you can say his name, the old man said. Louise says, I didn't create the sculpture to make a man climb a tall building with a banner and fall to his death in the process. The old man says, I know you didn't. That is why I'm here, to tell you that your art inspired Van, but it was his decision to act in the way that he did. Just as you interpret history and make art, he interpreted your art to make history. What he did was foolish, Louise said. Says, was it? I don't know myself. Maybe over the years, his act will seem less foolish and more heroic. The process of time can do that. We can criticize his act as of defiance now as a waste, but his courage was honorable. Are you working on a new sculpture? The old man says. Louise says, nope. The only thing I'm working on now is hanging this mirror. The old man says, it is not always the big moments that jar us out of inertia. It can be hearing a piece of music, laughing, seeing snow build up in a windowsill. Sometimes it is nothing but realizing we are all, in a way, alone, and it is up to us to survive that aloneness. You really should put down that mirror. Your arms must be in it.